Dynamically AI-generated user interfaces are the big new thing for Google, OpenAI, and probably a couple of other companies as well. Yesterday, Google announced a new project, the A2UI project. And of course, Google announcing projects is not the big thing. Google finishing projects is the more interesting part. Nonetheless, this project is interesting because it's not the only one of its kind. But what is it about? Well, here's the problem Google's trying to solve. When you're interacting with an AI agent, which basically just means an AI chatbot, in this context, you might be using it to reserve a table. So you might have a conversation like this, going back and forth, trying to reserve a table. Now, I don't know who's doing it like this. I mean, just go to Google Maps or the restaurant website and book from there, or shocking, pick up the phone and try that. But anyways, there might be some people doing it like this. And of course, there are definitely scenarios where you might want to get some task done with help of AI. And you might have conversations like this where you're going back and forth. And of course, that's not super efficient, obviously. So wouldn't it be nicer if the AI could instead render a user interface like this? A user interface specific for the task or the problem you're trying to solve or do right now. In this case, a restaurant reservation form. Of course, you might say, yeah, AI can do that. It can generate HTML code and, well, then ChatGPT or Gemini could display that. It's not that simple, but you're on the right track. I mean, one problem is that, of course, the UI the AI generates has to kind of fit the third-party service it then interacts with. Because if you're booking a restaurant table, Google is not booking it. Instead, behind the scenes, some third-party service like OpenTable might be used, which then does the actual reservation. So the AI needs to communicate with OpenTable, and the user interface it renders, of course, must be in line with the data OpenTable expects and supports. So it's a bit trickier than that. And that's kind of the problem A2UI tries to solve, but it's not the only one, because of course, OpenTable or any other restaurant reservation service could, of course, as part of its API to help AI agents, return an example user interface, some example HTML code that could be rendered that's in line with the data they expect to get. But the problem you then have, of course, is that this HTML code must be rendered in a sandbox by Gemini or ChatGPT, because you definitely don't want to blindly trust HTML code you don't own, code that especially might have been manipulated by the AI between the response from that service and what's landing on the screen. So you want to render it in a sandboxed iframe, which has some problems. And in addition, of course, the UI will not look like the rest of ChatGPT or Gemini. It might look totally different. I mean, OpenTable might be using a red color palette. Gemini is using a blue color palette. So that UI widget looks kind of a alien thing in the overall user interface. And that's the kind of problem, the main problem A2UI is trying to solve. Their pitch is that it would be nice to have dynamically generated user interfaces that are in line with the branding of the AI agent, so with Gemini, for example, and that still support the kind of data or requirements that third-party service the AI is interacting with needs. And that's what A2UI tries to solve. How does A2UI try to solve this? Well, their idea is that you don't exchange HTML, but instead JSON that describes the user interface, specifically JSON that describes different components that make up the user interface, like a text component, a date time input component, a button component. That is what that third-party service, so the restaurant reservation service, for example, is sending back to the AI agent. And then the application, which wraps the AI agent, so Gemini, for example, or ChatGPT, uses that JSON data to translate it to its own UI components. Therefore, the idea behind A2UI also is that your application can expose a catalog of supported components, and then the AI agent can basically use that catalog so that you can have dynamically purpose-built user interfaces that are in line with your component catalog and still are totally flexible and work with any third-party service your AI agent might be integrating with. And of course, it's then not just about the UI. Instead, the idea also, of course, is that you exchange data with that third-party service so that in the end, you can render the UI, but also have the data that should be displayed in that UI and not just the empty components. So that in the end, you end up with an AI-powered application like ChatGPT that can render all kinds of UI widgets for all kinds of third-party services or use cases it might support. Now, Google's not the first company to identify this problem and try to solve it. OpenAI in October already released the Apps SDK, which had a similar purpose. The idea behind the Apps SDK, however, is to support building apps for ChatGPT. So not a general protocol or a solution that should work with any AI agent and any third-party service, but instead, the Apps SDK really tries to give third-party services like restaurant reservation services a tool they can use to build HTML widgets or components that can be rendered inside of ChatGPT and that can then also interact with those services and their data. So if you were owning such a third-party service, such a reservation service, for example, you could define some HTML document, some JavaScript code to make it interactive. And you would also define an interface, a standardized interface, which is used by ChatGPT to inject data into that dynamically rendered HTML document. And what's important is that here we're talking about HTML again. So that would be rendered in an iframe and it would come with the styling you as the service owner defined, not with the styling ChatGPT would like to have or OpenAI would like to have. Instead, you as the owner of the service ChatGPT is integrating with define the UI, and the only thing that's dynamic is whether ChatGPT will render it or not and the kind of data it will inject into it, because that will be the data the AI agent derives from your other endpoints, from your MCP server, or it dynamically generated, depending on the kind of problem your UI is trying to solve. The Apps SDK integrates with MCP and simply exposes this service-defined UI as another resource, so that besides tools or other resources you might be exposing on your MCP server, you could also expose UI widgets, so that AI agents could not just call tools and get data, but also get UI widgets that they can render to then present that data in a better way or make that tool call work with a certain UI. That's the idea. But again, this is all focused on ChatGPT. Now, MCP, of course, is not ChatGPT specific. That's why the MCP standard is also evolving to have a more general approach for supporting basically the same pattern, where you as the owner of an MCP server can expose UI widgets, HTML in the end, but not in a way that only works with ChatGPT, but instead in a more general way. The idea is the same though. You can expose extra resources, which are HTML widgets, along with your tools and other resources so that AI agents can render them. And the key difference to A2UI is that in A2UI, we're not talking about HTML, but about the JSON description of the UI, and it would be the host application, ChatGPT, for example, that then translates those JSON instructions into the actual UI, eliminating some security concerns and allowing for full styling control, for example. All three approaches still try to solve the same problem, though, dynamically generated, purpose-built user interface snippets, widgets, that should be integrated into AI applications. And therefore, I got a couple of thoughts about this. I generally see the idea and the advantage behind this, and I agree there will be certain tasks where having a purpose-built user interface might make things simpler. When it comes to reserving a restaurant table, I might just be a bit old school. I'm the kind of person that maybe also wants to read some reviews, and I can do that on Google Maps, and I also might want to look at some pictures, and of course I could ask the AI for all of that, but yeah, I can just go to the place where I know it's all there, which is Google Maps or to some degree the restaurant website, and then I can also make the reservation from there. But Of course, I definitely see the point that making reservations in general is something that could be integrated into an AI conversation. If not for restaurants, then maybe for activities where I'm using ChatGPT to research which kind of activities I can do in my next vacation in France, in Marseille, and then I might just book my museum ticket from right inside ChatGPT. So I definitely see it for that. And I see the advantage of this approach for most of these one-off tasks. And all these tasks, I'd say, are defined by the fact that I wouldn't necessarily go to the website of the service provider in the first place. I'm booking a restaurant from the restaurant site, not from the Open Table website. I'm maybe booking a museum from some activity aggregator website and not from the museum website. And I don't care too much about which activity aggregator website I'm using. So when it's about these kinds of tasks where there isn't a strong connection to the actual site I would normally go to, I totally see that I could do that from inside an AI assistant. Now, it already gets a bit trickier if we talk about something like sending email, which is also an example here. Sure, you could argue maybe for certain tasks, if I'm using ChatGPT to discuss how to best send a message to my boss to tell him that he sucks, maybe it's then nice to be able to send it right from inside ChatGPT. But in general, for managing emails, I will probably stay in my email client. The same would be the case for generating images. If I have an application like Canva, there already it gets a bit blurry. Sure, if I just need a quick graphic, just a quick image, I can already do that with AI right inside of the chatbots today, of course. But once I need to do a bit more, just rendering a widget, no matter how purpose-built it might be, might get tricky. But I guess we'll see if that is something that gets picked up by the industry and how well it works. Overall, though, I think the direction is pretty clear. Google, OpenAI, and all those other providers have one clear goal: become a new app store, kind of. Of course, it's in their interest if users spend as much time as possible in their chatbots, and if they have all these mini apps in there, all these widgets in there that allow users to do all kinds of things. And don't get me wrong, that could also be in the interest of those users, because you can get a lot of things done from one place, just as we can get a lot of things done from our phones today because of the app stores and all the apps we can install there. So the main questions, I guess, will be: which approach will win, Google's approach or the MCP approach? MCP, of course, has the advantage that it already is a standard that's having a significant amount of adoption, and Google also has that issue that, well, not all of its projects survive to the end. But of course, its approach of letting the host application render a fitting UI does have its merits. So that will be one question. The other big question, of course, is which services want to support that? And I think clearly services like reservation services, they have a huge interest in supporting that because they are getting paid by the entities where you can reserve in. So if you're reserving a restaurant table, you're not paying for it, the restaurant is. So of course, those services have an interest in reaching as many people as possible and making it as easy as possible for people to reserve. By the way, one thing that will of course be interesting is there is more than one reservation service. Which one will get picked by the AI? The one that pays the most, or is it random? Well, we'll see. Things may look different though for services where you, as the user, are directly paying for the service. Things like Canva, for example. Because, of course, for one, they might not be able to offer you all their features in those small widgets, and they also lose the direct access to you. Because even if you probably have to pay in order to use the Canva widget in ChatGPT, so they earn money off that, they don't have that direct connection to you, just as there is no direct connection to you in the app stores, and you have to pay a commission to Apple or Google there too. So that might, of course, be something that turns those service providers off. And in addition, it's, of course, harder to cross-promote or upsell you if you just render small widgets and you have no chance of showing a little promotion banner at the top of the page. And of course, that might not be your problem as a user, but it might be if those services don't end up in ChatGPT. It of course also is possible that they will end up because they don't want to get left behind. And that is simply something we have yet to see. We don't know yet. It's all brand new and evolving. So these are just my thoughts. We'll see how things look like in a year from now. But definitely let me know what your thoughts about this are, and see you in future videos.